Good day everybody. This is going to be the second video on how to read borehole logs. The first video was about mostly soil deposits. In this video I would like to talk about rocks, core samples, how we describe rock samples, what properties we should look at. And let's look at this borehole log, the one I show here. This is real one. You will see that here, the first about 2 meters, there is no information provided here. And when we look at the description, we'll see that it's mostly soil, it's filling, clay, and here weathered siltstone. So this is soil material, that's why you're not gonna see any data on degree of weathering, nothing about rock strength, fracture spacing, and so on. So in this case it's soil, and we don't need to have these parameters locked in the borehole logs because soil doesn't really have much weathering and fracture spacing, right? If you've seen my video before, you will see that here we have S, which means that sample was taken at this depth, and then you will see that in this column called test results you will see these numbers. I hope by now you know what it means, right? It's the data from SPT test. So if you still don't know what it means, please watch my video. I'm gonna put the link in the description of this video. So what I would like to talk about in this video is this part. So this part of the borehole log, and explain what we have here, right? So you will see in the description, siltstone, and slightly different variation of siltstone. So this is rock, and because it's rock, you will see that it will have different levels of weathering. So you see the symbols here, and we'll talk about the symbols a little bit later. It's EW, HW, MW, SW, right? Another thing, you will see rock strength, and here you will see extremely low, very low, low. So again, I will explain later in this presentation what it means and how we get the symbols. Here we have water. Looks like there is no water in this borehole. That's fine. Another one is important is fracture spacing. So it's given in meters. When we look at core samples, right, like here rock, you will see that here, here, and over here, these are all discontinuities, so fractures, right? So this one spacing, it means the distance between these fractures, right? So what you see here, for this particular case for siltstone, you will see that spacing it's about 0.5 meters, 50 centimeters. So here about 20, 30 centimeters, here it's about 50. So you see that the spacing most of the time is greater than 10 centimeters, and that will give us a very high value of RQD. So here it's RQD in percentage. Again, I have a video on RQD, how we can measure RQD. Everybody can do it. Pretty simple, a straightforward procedure. Please watch that video. And if you see that RQD is 91%, it means it's a rock of high quality, which is pretty good. Well, another thing, it's core recovery 100%. Sometimes due to technical issues, we may not have 100% core recovery. It can be 90, 80%, so 20% lost. And very important part of this borehole log, the one that I will also explain in details a bit later, it's discontinuities. So all these little joints, fractions, we're going to look at each of them. You see some of them has a different color, some of them are open, some of them are closed. So this is something that we record. And for this particular case, we have very detailed description of discontinuities. You see it first was at the depth of 3.3 meters, next one 3.55 meters, 3.71 meters, and you see the symbols here. So at first they may look a little bit intimidating, but I'm going to explain what these symbols mean later. So that's probably it about borehole lock in general. Now let's look at next slide. And next slide, I'll just talk about graphic locks. Well, all these interesting patterns that we use to draw borehole locks. So you will see that here for each type of soil or type of rock, if it's a sedimentary rock or metamorphic rock, for this common types of rock, there is a certain pattern. Well, you don't really need to remember it. You can always look it up on the internet, or most of boreholes actually come with a legend. So legend will explain each of this pattern. So you don't really need to guess, or you don't need to like recall it. You can just look at the borehole legend, right? So this is just for general knowledge. What pattern we have for granite, something that we have for slate, this one for coal, it's black one, right? So that's kind of straightforward. Let's go to the next slide. This slide deals with the strength of rock material and gives you some idea how to name it. So you will see that it starts from extremely low, when it actually looks more like a soil material, then it will become very low, something that you can easily break with your fingers, with your thumb. So this is low, medium. So you will see that for low, you will need to, you can just easily break it with a hand. But for medium, you can probably break it, but it's with some difficulty. Well, unless you're like really, really strong. So when you cannot break it by hand, you can use a geological pick. And if you break the core with one firm blow, in this case, it's going to be high. Very high, well, you'll need more than one blow. Sometimes, like from our experience, maybe two or three, like really good blows of hammer that will define the score as very high strength. And extremely high, when you hit the rock with a geological pick and it will actually ring, you will hear that sound, bang, bang, bang. So in this case, you're gonna call this rock extremely high strength. Another important property of rock core samples, it's a degree of weathering. So if a rock is heavily weathered, that it will be very weak. If the rock is fresh or slightly weathered, so in this case, rock is actually of high strength. So these are the symbols that are commonly used to log core samples. So starting with fresh rock, so when has no stain, and it's nice and fresh material, then you will see that most of the rocks, they are slightly discolored, just a little bit, but in terms of the strength, they're still pretty high. Like fresh rock, in this case, we use symbol SW, slightly weathered. Then you just see if rock is moderately weathered or heavily weathered. So if it's heavily weathering, in this case, rock will be of discolored, strongly discolored, and the strength of the rock will be relatively low. So extremely weathered rock, it's weathered to the extent when it just becomes kind of like a soil-like material. So that would be pretty easy to see. Sometimes if you also add water, then it will deteriorate as well. So that's how we know that extremely weathered rock. So this just will give you some idea about the degree of weathering, and degree of weathering will also give you a very good indication of the strength. This part of the presentation deals with the description of discontinuities. You will see there so many symbols that we use. So we're going to start with a type of discontinuities. So it can be like beddings, cleavage. Most of the time you will see J or JS with joint or joins. Shade zone sometimes we can see in the core samples, right? So this is something that again we're going to write down because it's very important, the type of discontinuity. Then we're going to look at roughness, right? And roughness has its own division. So it's stepped, undulating, and planar. And for each of the states of the roughness, it can be rough or irregular. In this case, we use symbols RO, smooth, or slick-sided. So what you need to do again, you need to look at the surface and first decide if it's stepped, undulating, or planar, and then look at the degree of roughness. Next thing that we look at is aperture. So aperture, probably the best for engineers will be when it's closed. So aperture shows you if joints are closed, either they open, if they filled with some material, and usually we also provide the thickness of the filling. And also when we look at the filling, so in fill, sometimes it's open, joints are open, but they're clean. Sometimes joints will just have a stain, so it can be some kind of discoloration by minerals. Most of the time we see kind of brownish, which is iron. Then if we have a loss of that discoloration and it's less than 1 millimeter, if measured, so we're going to call it veneers. And if it's more than 1 millimeter, you will see it kind of like really thick layer of discolored rock. In this case, we call it coating. And we use the relevant symbols for all of them. So now let's see what we can see in the boreholes. For example, here, this is the statement. So in this case, we have joints, and they're inclined to the horizontal base from 20 to 40 degrees. Then in terms of the spacing and frequency, we have 4 joints per meter. And then we have roughness, which is undulating and rough surface. We have tight aperture, and we have stains. And we think that stain, it's a kind of brownish color because of iron. The one that I took from the borehole that I showed in the first slide, it's more detailed. You will see that for each discontinuity, it also provides the depth at which it was observed. So in this case, 3.5 meters. This is bearing plane, inclined at 5 degrees to the horizontal. Then it has a smooth undulating roughness. It also has, it's closed. And when they look at the surface of the discontinuities, it's a veneer. So there is less than 1 millimeter of discoloring of a film. This one is again pretty similar. So in this case, you will see that it's a joint type of discontinuity, inclined at 30 degrees, rough undulating surface. And it's actually open, well, it's not open aperture, it's filled and filled with material. So I don't know which material is there, but we know the filling is 8 millimeters. So that's how you read this information about discontinuities, and that's how you read borehole logs. Well, this video was a little bit long, but hopefully you've learned the basic, the fundamentals about rock coring and how to understand it. Thanks for watching this video. Have a nice day. Bye.